Welcome to the Property Couch, where each week you get to listen to two of Australia's leading experts. Bryce Holdaway, co-host of Location, Location, Location Australia on Foxtel's Lifestyle Channel, co-host of Escape from the City on the ABC, and partner of Empower Wealth Advisory. Ben Kingsley, Chair of Property Investors Council of Australia and the founder of Empower Wealth Advisory, named the 2018 and 2019 Property Advisory Firm of the Year. Stay tuned as they bring you the insider's guide to property, finance and money management.
All right, folks, welcome back to the Property Couch and welcome back to you, Ben.
Thank you, Bryce. Yes, good to be here. Social distancing, making sure we've got plenty of space between the two of us.
And Ives has got proof that we actually have got the required social distancing.
We're almost like 2 metres squared from each other, which is really, 4 metres, what is it?
Last week we're on Zoom. This week we were both in the office for other things and thought it's a good chance to record today. But Ben, we're really sort of... week three, sort of almost week four of talking about coronavirus. Yep. But we wanted to talk about something that's come up, which is really starting to fester around landlord versus tenant.
Yep.
And we really want to talk about some myths today. We want to also see if we can set the record straight and help people, both tenants and landlords, navigate what is an unprecedented time.
Well, there's the first myth, isn't it? Versus. It's not one versus the other. There are simply no winners in this conversation, right? It's difficult times. Everyone's feeling it. Everyone's affected. And so we don't want it to be that. But we've got some clarifying information that we want to definitely share to our community today in terms of what that looks like. So, and some ideas.
Yeah.
We've got some great ideas in terms of where we think that, more can be done to potentially help both the landlords and also the tenants. So it's going to be a good podcast.
What's not been sort of helpful is the way the headlines are gathered, because there's a couple of billionaires who are gathering the headlines, in terms of Solomon Liu saying that he's not going to pay rent for his commercial premises. And then there's also a very wealthy billionaire who is a landlord who's saying, no, I require my tenants to pay the rent. So those two headlines certainly... don't lend any sympathy in the marketplace when you're talking about a couple of billionaires. But I think the point of that is a very small minority of the people, because we've said it a couple of times over the last couple of weeks, but we have clients who are trying to self-fund and they're not fat cats. They're not flush with cash. They're actually managing money in a way that they can accumulate over time so they can be self-funded. But for them to be in a situation where tenants are not paying the rent, will put them under duress just as much as the tenants are under duress if they lose their job.
There's definitely different audiences there, Bryce. I mean, if we talk about the three main audiences, right, in terms of from a landlord point of view, there's a landlord who's negative cash flow. So that basically means that they rely on that rent heavily. And if they don't get that rent, they're potentially, their household, in terms of their financial story and putting food on the table for their family is real. And if they have to do a repayment pause, which we'll get into later, there's an absolute financial cost. There potentially are landlords out there who are cash flow positive, but may not, or neutral or positive, but may not be enough. Ultimately there's still maintenance and upkeep for that property. And then there's the landlord who isn't spoken about a lot, but basically, we might call them the quiet property investor, who are retired, and their situation is quite unique. They are not getting, because they don't meet the test around the asset test, so the means test, they aren't getting a pension, right? So they might get some one-off payments if that's not means tested, but most of it isn't. So the 750 they don't get. They're not getting any of these job seeker or job keeper relief. So those people are basically getting no assistance at all and effectively rely on that rental income. That's what they live off. So, if they're caught up in the fact that their tenants don't want to pay them, well, they are going to be in all sort of financial distress, because they also have financial commitments as well.
So the important point here is that we're all in this together, right? So part of it is working together with government, working together with the banks, working together with your tenants. But in chatting with one of our good friends and one of the property managers that has appeared on our podcast, I was chatting with Caroline yesterday.
Yep.
And I guess the concern from her, probably on behalf of property managers, where people are just ringing up saying, hey, look, I think there's an opportunity on offer here. I want to negotiate on my rent.
Yeah.
And the next question is, okay, fine, let's talk about what sort of hardship are you under And they said, no, I'm not under any hardship, but a friend of mine just said that we can negotiate on our rent. That's very common.
There's a lot of misinformation out there at the moment, Bryce, and hopefully this podcast today will clarify that misinformation.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's definitely a challenge, right? So there are a few solutions, but folks, we want to set the record straight that if you are listening to this and you are a tenant, unless you're under, you know, financial hardship, it's still paying the rent when it forms due. A couple of things that she talked about too, which was helpful though, is because she's in an area where the average rent would be above the average or median for Melbourne is.
Yep.
What they're doing with some of the tenants, which I thought was really great, is instead of having monthly paid, what she's done is negotiate where they're paying weekly. And so what that's doing is giving the tenant a sense of, I'm more in control, I can do this in baby steps, everything's moving so quickly, I can pay 1 week,
Yep. The
next week I can pay another week. And she's reporting that the default is very, very low,
Yep. But
it's also meaning that people are just, it's taking away a layer of anxiety where people are looking at a big lump sum of a monthly rent payment versus broken it up into four, you know, it's not exactly 4 weeks, four parts, but roughly four parts, it's actually digestible. And it's something people would do. So
we've got a lot to talk about today.
We do.
But let's get started.
All right, my mindset minute theme today. I've got two, Ben. I've got two quotes that I really want to tie in. But this one's from E. Joseph Kosman. If you want to test your memory, try to recall what you were worrying about 1 year ago today.
Ooh.
Now, it's probably reasonably easy because you're probably thinking, well, there's, for us, negative gearing.
Yeah.
We're thinking, But generally speaking, what were you worried about last week? What were you worried about a month ago? What were you worried about 6 months ago? You generally can't remember.
Yep.
So it's kind of just to give people peace that in 3 years' time, we won't be talking about the coronavirus. It will have passed. It will have run its course. I remember post the Brisbane floods in 2011, stretching my memory.
That's right. Yep.
You know, in 2011, 2012, it was very much. But now, who's talking about the Brisbane floods, even though that was a massive event at the time? Right, so clearly we need to put this in perspective that it's whenever we talk on this podcast, we're talking about it from a financial economic perspective.
Correct.
In no way belittling any of the health challenges any family member might be under.
This is a monumentous event globally. We understand that there's going to be a lot of people who are affected.
Yeah.
So we don't want to displace that. But as you say, we're not. You know, this is not a medical podcast.
No.
We're in. You know, we do say to people, just reminding people, don't go out. If you do have to go out, essentially, don't touch anyone, don't touch anything.
Yep.
Get home because it's working. So, you know, keep up that framework. And because we're an island and, we could be better off than some, you know, of the connected European nations and so forth. But again, that's our podcast here is about financial transformation, about helping people, educating people on money, finance and property. And we're going to be doing that today.
Second quote I want to talk about, Ben, is from Jack London, who's an American novelist. Life is not always a matter of holding good cards, but sometimes playing a poor hand well. And I guess that's for people right now, it feels like a poor hand has been dealt us. And for a lot of people, it's been a significantly poor hand.
Yes.
But it's about how you actually play that poor hand, not about sort of thinking, oh, geez, it was a good hand prior to this and it's all happening.
Yep.
So just keep the worry in check, folks. And also just, how are you going to respond? What story are you going to tell yourself? What information are you going to dine out on? We've talked about being careful of how much news you're digesting at this point in time and who you're digesting that news from. So
yes, agreed.
There you go, folks. Hopefully that'll set you up for this week. But as you said, Ben, we are going to talk today about, we've talked, you know, landlord versus tenant, but we want to break that down and see
Correct.
What that actually looks like.
So. Yeah. So I think that the best place to start here is we obviously have been talking to lots of landlords and lots of property managers and also industry leaders in this particular space from the REIA, so that's the Real Estate Institute of Australia, and we've been getting out there. And one of the important things to remind the community is that hardship can be experienced in any different type of market. So by way of example, businesses fail even in good economic times as well as they do in bad economic times. So the property managers are usually well versed with this, as are all of the government institutions and associations around that. So, you know, there are already provisions in most tenancy acts around severe hardship. There are already processes and ways in which you can make claims and potentially get vouchers on your rent for severe hardship. So that is not new. What is new this time around is literally the scale of the situation, where we are seeing more and more media reports around tenants not being able to pay, and then you've got the governments of the day basically saying, work it out between yourselves. So we want to, and obviously in my capacity as the Property Investors Council of Australia's chair, are putting out a fact sheet in regards to this, and also giving a position in which we think it's really important for landlords to understand what their rights are and what's happening. Because the biggest misinformation at the moment, Bryce, is on both sides of the fence, where tenants think that landlords are getting a free kick with their banks. They think that they're getting free interest and not having to pay their repayments, and that should be enough for them to also get that pay down the line to them in terms of reduced rent. Now, the reality of that is further from the truth in terms of, and we've talked about that interest capitalising in...
They're paying more.
They will be paying more, okay? So, and the numbers we've talked about are in the thousands of dollars. So the idea that tenants, and even some landlords for that matter, think that they're getting a repayment holiday is not real. It is a repayment pause or a repayment freeze, whatever you want to call it. But it is a deferral. And that is the most important thing, that the landlords are going to have to pay that. So if any tenant's coming to the landlord and saying, I want you to cut me a deal, ultimately that could trigger the landlord being in no other place but to also do that. So there is no saving, and hence there's no winner in that type of outcome. So I think it's really important to understand that's the biggest bit of misinformation that's out there, to think that they can do that. And then everyone's sort of saying, oh, I rang up my tenant and my landlord and they may have cut me a deal or whatever. We're saying really, really clear here, Bryce, our position for landlords is very much around, do not forego any rent. It's really important to understand that, but you do have other options. Exactly the same way as we have options in talking to our lenders as landlords, we have the option of deferring that. Correct. And so we're saying to landlords, as a starting position, all right, and that is find out the situation on both sides of the fence, right? Because we do believe good correspondence and good communication between each other will be really, really helpful. Because in the conversations, Bryce, that we've been having with the property managers, is that they are not qualified. They are not experienced, educated to make an assessment of people's financial situation. So just because you've lost the job doesn't necessarily mean that you're in financial hardship.
It gives them a difficult decision that they need to make, isn't it? Because ultimately, the property manager doesn't know if you've got any cash reserves. The property manager needs to have some evidence around if you are, you have lost your job. So, but ultimately, I guess the tenants want to have appropriate rental accommodation on the other side as well. So it's almost like, yeah, don't look for this as an opportunistic play. Look at this for whatever we can do. Just because you don't want to spend your savings, doesn't qualify for a reason for not paying your rent.
Well, it also highlights, Bryce, what we've been banging on about for over 270-odd shows, right? And that is, if you organise your money and you have a savings or a buffer, that's for emergencies, right? And that's to get you through, right, in terms of these types of situations. So I think it's really important that we understand that from a landlord's point of view, we love our tenants. You know, in the vast majority of cases, we absolutely do. But we're also mindful of the fact that there are financial commitments for those 2.5 million ordinary Australians who also need to put food on the table for their households as well. So if there can be an arrangement in place, if you can keep paying your rent, keep paying your rent, right? I mean, that's exactly what you know Carolyn said. Just go to a weekly payment or do whatever you can. It's the same sort of thing. If you ring the bank for hardship, they'll say, well, what can you pay? Or when they say, well, I can pay it all, well, keep paying it, because it's going to cost you more, because I'm going to interest capitalise on you. So all of a sudden it's like, stand down. I don't need to do that. Like, there's no free meal here. The only free meals in terms of, and we commend the government, because it's a good segue in terms of the governments have responded relatively quickly in terms of now going to be able to support the vast majority of tenants who've lost their jobs. And so I think that's probably the first thing we want to talk about in terms of what is available to tenants right now who may have lost their jobs and are thinking about how do they cover their rent as well as their other financial commitments. And there are two main things that they've got available to them. Obviously, the first one was, you know, if you're unemployed, you go and get your new start. Now, your new start is $550 per fortnight. Now, the next stimulus, or the first bit of stimulus that the government put on top of that, was another $550, which equates to $1,100 per fortnight for what is referred to as the job seeker payment for when you're unemployed. So that's $2,200 per month that's going to help you with not only your rent, but also with, you know, your other commitments in terms of your essentials, putting food on the table for you and your family, right? We can't go out and spend it. There's no discretionary activity that's allowed at the moment that's going to cost money. So that's the first one. And then the biggest, and to put this in the context, $130 billion third phase stimulus, that's half of what the government spends every year across its entire budget. So that is by far the biggest stimulus program we've ever seen. And that's underpinning 6 million people. So we've got the unemployed level and now potentially these job seekers, and they are going to get $1,500 a fortnight or $3,000 per month. Now, if two of the family members, let's say if it is a couple, or even if you're house sharing or flatmates, everyone's going to either have the job seeker or the job keeper allowance. So there's going to be in excess of, you know, sort of $3,000 to $6,000 that may be flowing into the household to keep them afloat. And we're saying that's great, and also to keep paying your rent. And I think that's a really important message.
Yeah, well, Ben, because the JobKeeper is going through the employer first, isn't
correct.
It? But it ultimately ends up allowing them to keep their job.
Yep.
So, because we talked last week about the fact that the unemployment figures would reflect quite a few people who have been stood down.
Yes.
Well, that essentially is underpinning some of those people who think, well, the stood down part of that category are the people that are likely to get the job back at the other side. So it's really underpinning that so we can give people the confidence that they can meet their needs. But really it's about shelter, food, utilities,
the essentials
that people still need to have those commitments. It's around the discretionary spend where people can actually save a few pennies. That's where they can put back into their war chest of their savings. But I think the message that we wanted to get across today very clearly from the conversations that we're having both with clients, with property managers, is that the tenants, you are still required to pay your rent.
Yes.
Unless there is some significant hardship, but it's not a default that you'll get rent concessions. You need to talk to the landlord and the landlord. Because I know in talking to quite a few people, there's landlords out there who are very keen to provide an opportunity for people to get through to the other side. So it's all about nurturing people through. But as you said before, we want to make sure people know that it's not about a free kick in front of goal for the tenant just because they don't want to pay. They've got to continue to pay it. But you also want to be working hand in glove with the landlord to see it through. But the ramifications for landlords, and we obviously are representing landlords a lot within our podcast.
Yep, our community.
Is that it has flow-on effects for, you know, landlord protection insurance is one, for example. So if you were to agree to a reduction in the rent, any policy that would be covered, and it's subject to specific fine print within each policy, but they would go to the rent that you'd agreed to drop to, not the original rent.
Correct.
Which is really important. So it does have flow-on effects for landlord's insurance, but there are, I guess our point is saying, don't panic into having a reduction. Have a well-considered, thought-out approach with a conversation between the three parties. Let's not sort of let's not stay isolated and not talk to each other.
That's right. I mean, you know, your property manager is going to be that conduit in terms of how it brings you together. But just to give you an idea, because there has been some movement, some significant movement in regards to landlords' protection insurances. So we're not seeing much movement in regards to building and contents damage from a tenant, but we are definitely seeing some movement in regards to rental income lost, and then basically making a claim on that. And We understand that basically if you ring any of the major landlord protection insurers at the moment, it's very difficult to get that into that current policy. Mm. And I want to just read out, because I think this is really important in terms of, and this is a general statement around policy only, please. It's obviously going to be specific to the different insurance companies, but it's really clear in terms of what Bryce was just saying. If a landlord offers or agrees to a rental reduction or no rent at all, the landlord protection policy will not cover the difference, the gap between the old and the new agreement. So if you drop that rent by $100 or $200 and then they don't pay, the landlord policy will only pay out on that bottom figure. So this is why property managers are telling their landlords correctly, because at the end of the day, they receive a fee from the money that they're engaged by the landlord to manage the property and the asset on their behalf. So this is where it becomes, you know, it's all well and good for the governments to be saying, sort it out amongst yourselves, but these are the unintended or the consequences that happen downstream that are quite difficult. So it's really important to understand. If the landlord makes a loss on the rental claim, then the insurer will consider the weekly rent to be agreed reduced rent. That's the point there, right? So if a tenant defaults on payment in order of loss of rent claim to be considered, the property manager needs to follow the Rental Tenancy Act, and that'll be different in every state and territory, and treat the rental arrears as they normally would, i.e. they still need to serve the prescribed notice and apply for the relevant tribunal for eviction. So this is where it gets awkward, right? Because ultimately there is a process of eviction, and we absolutely know that there is a moratorium where you cannot evict at the moment. That's a really important thing. So we park that. You can't do the eviction, but you're still potentially going to have these awkward conversations through the property manager with a tenant and say, if you're going to go on a payment plan, you're still not paying the required amount. So I'm still going to serve you with a notice because I've still got to follow protocols and policies and regulations to make sure that the insurance is going to be able to claim on. Because if you've gone and been paying this insurance for the last 2 or 3 years and you've never called on it, this is exactly why you pay it. And we talk about defence all the time. And this is a mandatory part of the defence that we should say every household should have if they're investing in property. So we've got this situation where potentially they won't be able to make a claim if they do that. That's why we're saying, and that's why I'm wearing my hat as the picker chair, to basically say no foregoing of rent. Okay, look for alternatives where you can defer that rent and then the landlords will have to follow that policy in terms of what that looks like. So it then finally goes on, given that the bans of evictions for 6 months, it effectively means that any loss of rent claim will not be processed until after the eviction ban has ended and the tenants have potentially been evicted. Mm. So again, we want tenants to be happily enjoying the space and the accommodation that's being provided for them. Because on the flip side of this, Bryce, is if the tenant isn't paying rent, under the law, we as the property owner need to keep the property in good, lettable order. So if a hot water system breaks down, the dishwasher breaks, or if their light fails or the heater fails during winter, we still have to, even if they're not paying rent, still have to maintain the property. So we get into trouble for not putting all this extra money into the property, even though the tenants may not be paying. So it's really important to understand that. But the other point, and I'll just finally round that off, in terms of loss of rent limited, in most policies are to 16 or 20 weeks. So that's what most of your loss of rent policy will cover you for. So again, it's in the best interest for the landlord to be having conversations, but also informing the tenant of that particular thing. Because if I just want to talk about what tenants think that they can do, this doesn't mean that you can break the lease though, Bryce. Mm. Okay, so it's important to understand you can't be evicted, but if you're a tenant thinking, oh, I'm just going to leave, well, there are costs. And it's really important for you to understand those costs in terms of what they look like. Because if you then get an understanding of what those costs are, all of a sudden the tenant's going to be significantly out of pocket, because this is what's referred to as tenancy hardship. So if we have a look at that.
Yeah, because the break lease for cost for a tenant, so if you do break it on hardship or giving up possession, the landlord can actually claim compensation for any reasonable cost they Correct. Have to pay as a result of you breaking the lease. So this, this could be liable for a reletting fee, And you also could get the reasonable advertising costs. And also rent until new tenants move in. So you've got to mitigate the loss of that time between when you moved to the next tenant in. If there's a gap in between, you're effectively underpinning that because you're trying to break a fixed term. So in principle, the tenant, you entered into a binding agreement with a landlord, and you want to break that. You've got to make good and make it so that the landlord is largely not out of pocket to get someone else in. So be aware that it's not just a case of handing the keys back and saying, I'm going to sleep on someone else's couch.
And there's a clear process here, right, in terms of you've got to go to the administrative tribunal in that state or territory. So it's a formal process. And in terms of what we were sort of saying, any of the charges, so if you're claiming for tenancy hardship, or it's got to be demonstrated as severe. So you're going to have to show all your financials. You're going to have to show all your assets. And if you've got savings, and if you've got other assets, car, whatever it is, that may not be severe. So ultimately, the tribunal can potentially not accept a claim for hardship. So you've gone through this process thinking, and what we are seeing, and again, it's not mass, but we are seeing it out there where tenants are haggling with their landlord, basically saying, well, I'm just going to leave. It's like, well, before you make these accusations and claims and, you know, threats about leaving, you probably need to read up on the laws in your state or territory in terms of being able to move out of that property, because there is going to be a financial cost.
Well, there's going to be a reputation cost too, Ben, because if you do that, the property manager, let's just say you do that and you walk out and you don't pay it, you're going to have a black mark against your record, Ben. And at the other side of this, you will want to rent another property and that'll make it very, very difficult for you. So it's like when you go in an Uber, Ben, and you treat the Uber driver poorly, they will mark you down with a poor star. You go onto eBay, you do a transaction, they'll mark you down with a poor star rating. The same will apply here. So it's important, folks. Here's the deal. Here's the bigger picture. Let's leave the negotiation to the people who are in genuine hardship, right? If you are someone who just wants to see an opportunistic time to actually reduce your rent, that is not the Australian way. That is not. The landlords are not fat cats. They are trying to meet their obligations too. So therefore, the people who are in a scenario where they do need some assistance, talk to your property manager, who will then enter into a conversation with the landlord, who can then put you into a similar arrangement that the banks are now putting in place for the majority of Australians who have a loan, Ben. They are prepared to say, we understand that the time is such that you need some help, we got that, but they are going to put the cost on later so that they can actually get through this time. It is a similar approach that the landlord would want to be taking. Sure, we can help you get through this together because I want you to be a part of my property investment journey as much as you need the roof over your head going forward, but there is, you said it before, there's no such thing as a free lunch. And importantly, the property investors are not getting free money.
Yeah, they have rights too. And I think that's important. And obviously the vast majority of the community who listen to our podcasts are either budding property investors or property investors themselves. So we're also informing you that you need to understand that you have the rights to claim these costs, and they need to be informed to the tenant who's potentially doing a veiled threat in terms of saying that they're going to leave your accommodation. So it's really important. That's why we're sort of saying keep it to looking at solutions that are deferrals, don't forego any rent, and inform the tenants, and the property manager will do that, of what is applicable in your state or territory around how you do break a lease in residential property through this tenancy hardship model. If you're going down that path as a tenant, it is going to be costly, and you're going to have to find alternative accommodation in terms of doing that. So be mindful of that. I think that's a really important message.
I guess that's kind of the bigger picture approach of how tenants should be viewing this particular scenario. But let's talk about a few things where we know what the banks can do at this point in time, and they've been doing that and they've been playing their role quite well. But what can governments do to help both the landlord and the tenants through this time, Ben? So clearly the federal government has done some stimulus packages that allow people to shore up some of their short-term cash flow, enable businesses to keep as many employees as they can so that we can all get through the other side. So what would be interesting is to see if there is a rental assistance package, which hasn't been announced at this point, but whether there is a specific way to help underpin the rents that people are paying. I guess some of those stimulus is already doing that in a broader way.
Very much so. They are catching most of those people, but there are still people in society that do need a safety net. They do need to be caught, and there's potential for the governments, and we're calling on the governments to step in and look at a rental relief package for those people who haven't been caught up in that. So if you're a pensioner and you rent, there are different programs. And I think it's also important for the governments to understand, and also for, again, our community to understand what actually happens in this case. So we have a lot of landlords across Australia who actually rent property to people who are unemployed, who are on Newstart. And what actually happens is there is a very effective process that actually works for these people. And you may have, you know, with unemployment rising, you may have this experience with your tenant that's currently in place, and this is how it works. So what actually happens is there's a thing called centre pay, okay? And that payment each fortnight actually goes to the property manager. So the Centrelink make that payment through centre pay, it goes into the property management system, and the property manager obviously then ledges that out against the rent that's due. So that's really helpful for people, like what Carolyn was doing in terms of make it weekly so I can manage my money a bit. They don't see that money.
Correct.
They only see the remainder of that money going into their bank account, and then they know how much they've got available to live on. Mm. So we have the facility in place, and for those people who are experiencing severe hardship, and as landlords, we need to understand that they do have ports of call. So tenants do have ports of call, and the property managers will be explaining to those that you can, you know, we want the tenants to absolutely ring the tenancy associations in their particular area and get their own advice. But in terms of the landlords are going to get their advice from their professional manager, and the vast majority of professional managers are basically saying that we're waiting for the government to give us some indication around any type of rental relief program. But at the moment, I think the government are basically saying, hey, we are, you know, we've spent over $350 odd billion in terms of keeping the cash flowing in the economy. We think that there's enough in there to cover the rent. So we've just got to wait and see in terms of what that happens. But that would be an excellent one for the federal governments to look at in regards to helping out the tenants and the landlords in these difficult times.
The other one, Ben, is just to reverse some of the decisions they made back in the budget night, May, was it 2017?
Something like that, when we got surprised about, yep.
Around depreciation. So,
yes.
Because really what a landlord needs right now is to be able to provide further offsets for them to claim back further tax, so that then they might be in a position to forego,
yep.
Defer,
yes.
some of the payments from the tenant so they can help them out. So reversal of that, reversal of,
yep.
the expense to travel. Now, people can't necessarily jump on a plane.
No.
But they can, over time, when we can jump back on planes, that will certainly help on a lag effect,
yep.
To do that. So that's in the core.
That improves cash flow, and if the landlord has better cash flow, the property investor has better cash flow, they may be open to, you know, some type of arrangement with the tenant. But the starting position is still not to forego that, but having a look at what that looks like. And a quick little important message there, Bryce, because we haven't spoken about this for a while, but depreciation helps with cash flow. So if you don't have a situation, if you haven't got depreciation schedule on your property, the first thing you need to do, and we don't get any money for this, ring BMT.
We'll put the link in the show.
Ring BMT.
We get a discount for
all of the podcast listeners. So mention the Property Couch. Ring them now and talk to them on the phone and say, is it worth my while to get a depreciation schedule done? They'll do some rough numbers with you, and that'll give you a gauge in terms of whether it's worth investing to get this cash flow back. If it's not, then stand down. But if it is, what an amazing opportunity to help with cash flow in these difficult times. And that potentially means that, you know, there can be some help going to both the landlord and ultimately the tenant, if possible.
The federal government already have something in place, Ben. We talked about last week, just a reminder that you can get a variation on your tax. So
yes.
If you're expecting a tax refund, and for some people, they'd be, if they've got lower income expectations because of this event, Ben.
Yes.
They could actually say, well, I'm due a tax refund. It's a Form 1515 withholding variation, yep. form, Ben. And you can actually say, I don't want to wait until I lodge my tax return to get my tax relief.
Mm.
I can get it back weekly, fortnightly,
yep,
a month.
Through payroll.
depending on how you actually get paid. They send a letter to the employer and they say, can you please pay Johnny or Wendy $100 more in their pay packet, because at the end of the year they're probably going to get that refund anyway. So just to keep that in mind, that that is already in place, folks. It's been a resource for property investors for many, many years, where they can actually get that cash flow relief straight away. But for folks who are out there expecting a tax refund, that is something that you might want to explore as well.
So let's recap. Federal governments, basically, they've already got the JobKeeper and the JobSeeker packages. We think that they could do more in regards to depreciation and letting us claim what is the write-down value of the property, of the fixtures and fittings inside the property. We think that, that was a harsh call when they banned us from that, so they could look at that. Obviously, they could look at, from a federal level, a rental assistance or a relief package in association with that, which leads us into also then the state and territory governments, because ultimately we've got to remember that property is a state and territory-based activity. We pay our stamp duties and also our land taxes to the state governments. So the big standout here in terms of helping out landlords who can then potentially help our tenants is, why should they not forego? So why don't they forego any land tax for the next 12 months? And that's, for some people, that's a couple of $100s. For other people, that's thousands. And for some people, it's tens of thousands of dollars. Now, if the landlord's getting that money, then all of a sudden they potentially have a bit of wriggle room and a bit of a war chest to potentially help their tenants who are in true financial distress to be able to do that. So that is one thing that we do think that the state and territory governments could do. They could also jump in on the program around a tenancy relief package. So that could be another thing, like that could be a coordinated effort for both federal and state governments to also do that. But until that time, and I would be saying to tenants and to landlords, that I'm not sure that's on the immediate radar. So if we, if this virus and health issue and economic crisis from that health issue stems more than 6 months, maybe it might be on the cards. But in the short term, I think the governments are saying, they're probably, federal government at least, are saying they've probably done enough. But we're still calling on them to look at, for those people who are really affected, that there should be some type of rental relief. And that should be worked through the MyGov, because when you are applying for your job seeker package, you have to put all your financials in there, everything. The properties you own, the assets you own, the income, the savings, because they will do investigations and it's a statutory declaration. So if you lie on that and they find out that you've got other assets or other wealth, you're going to be, not only have to repay that money, but potentially also be fined for lying on the application. So, and that comes back to the property managers. They're in no position to judge whether someone, you know, believing the whole story, nor is the landlord to believe that full story of the tenant. What needs to happen is the government needs to step in and they need to fill out this stat deck and have that investigated and then show proof that they are on a job seeker allowance, because on a job keeper allowance, really they've got enough money to pay the rent. On a job seeker, then the landlord's going to say, okay, it's a truthful conversation. What can I look at doing? How can I play a role in helping them through that program?
Yeah, so then you pivot to the banks, Ben, and so they clearly have put their hand up to say, we want to protect our customers to get through the other side, because they are, you know, they're playing the long game on that. But one of the other things they could do is really level the playing field around interest only versus principal and interest. So there's clearly an opportunity to let people switch to interest only, because that would provide immediate cash flow relief to them straight away.
But, correct.
But also change, you know, clearly there was a time when APRA needed to step in and put a handbrake onto the system because investor activity was out of control and we were in a massively booming market. Now, clearly that's not the case now. So it kind of makes sense that we could get the parity back between what you're buying, what you're getting money for at an owner-occupier level, what you're getting money at an investment level, because that would make another significant difference to the amount of cash flow that's flowing into ordinary mum and dads who are trying to self-fund into their coffers as well, so that they can navigate their way through and, again, be in a better position to support the tenants.
This is all about cash flow. For the short term, this is a cash flow crisis.
It absolutely is.
So if the landlord is being able to have a better situation around their cash flow, then they've got wriggle room. If they don't, and they're forced into, as I said, taking the repayment holiday, which it ain't, it's just basically you have to pay more in a deferral to the banks, that is an excellent way in which they can do it. So APRA is in control of that with the banks. So what's stopping people being able to switch to interest only from principal and interest is you have to do a full credit assessment. All right, now that's not ideal. In the past, you never had to do a credit assessment to be able to switch from principal and interest to interest only. And so we think the risk has passed from the amount of property investors going into the market. We talked about it extensively through 2016 and into 17 on our podcast. We thought there was too many property investors out there. Some intervention needs to happen. So we were supportive of that. That has passed now. And so being able to let the landlords go to an interest-only payment delivers hundreds, if not potentially thousands of dollars per month back into the coffers of those landlords or property investors. Now, what would we say? That sits straight in the offsets, guys, for you guys. But if there's then give you some wriggle room to have a further negotiation in terms of how you may be able to help the tenants, maybe pay a bill for them, or whatever you think it might be a way in which you can do that, that's really important. And there's one other big thing that also happened during that period, Bryce, and that is that banks started to charge a premium for investors. So what could they do there?
Yeah, clearly, as I mentioned before, clearly just bridge that gap to allow it to be the same rate, whether you're an owner-occupier or an investor.
There is no reason why, if you've got, you know, one Smith Street versus two Smith Street, and what the banks are securing exactly the same asset, right? Yet they're charging a premium, and in some cases as much as 80 basis points to allow for people to have an investment when it's secured by exactly the same thing. Worse still, Bryce, is the evidence suggests, and it continues to show up, that investors' default levels are better in terms of they default less than an owner-occupier does, both in the principal and interest and also the interest-only field. So there really is no argument for the banks to say that they need to have a premium. Now, the money markets will probably argue that, you know, we charge a premium for that because we think there's increased risk. But the reality is, with what the Reserve Bank governor has just done around the access to money for the banks at 0.25, with very little margin on top of that, they can potentially access this money and give what we had in 2014-15 for almost 12 years there, where we had interest rates exactly the same between owner-occupiers and investors. We need to get back there because that is going to be a good stimulus for the economy and also allow landlords to help out their tenants where applicable.
Very good, Ben. So I guess there's a few things that we're calling on for federal government, state and territory governments, and a little bit more that the banks can be doing to help people through. But I guess the overarching message for this is it is not tenant versus landlord. It's
definitely not.
We need to work collaboratively to get through this. But equally, we're championing the cause that landlords cannot shoulder the burden. Because they are just facing the challenges the same as everyone else, Ben. So,
and Bryce, so I've put my picker hat on. This is exactly why picker has been formed, because property investors, aka landlords, need an association the same way in which tenants have an association right around the country that gets government funding, millions of dollars of government funding. We get no government funding. We run this from the smell of an oily rag. We don't get paid to do the work we do. We're all volunteers. We're mum and dad investors supporting mum and dad investors. Now, we're putting together a fact sheet on this particular bit of information. That will be available in the next couple of days, but it'll be available for members only. So it's $5 to join if you want for a year, or $20 for 5 years. So we are calling on, if this has been helpful for you in terms of understanding that a tenant can't just threaten you and breaking their lease, they're going to be up for some costs. There's a process that they have to go through, and being opportunistic versus the ones who have a genuine need here, because we want to separate those out. The ones who have a genuine need absolutely need consideration, but we're also recognising that the landlords themselves have a financial obligation to them and their families, and potentially this could be a threat to them as well. So please join, and if you can join, that would be great, because it helps us then provide the resources to put all this stuff together. It's just picker.asn.au, and you can join up there, and when you do join up, you'll get access to the fact sheet And you can also go to our Facebook page where there's a private group, and there'll be information in that private group over the course of the next couple of days as well. So that's an important message to all of those people who want representation on behalf of property investors, aka landlords.
Very well said, Ben. And remember, folks, tenants and landlords, we are all in this together. If we go back to last week when we talked about the five things you can do, Ben, stay home unless you absolutely have to go out. Don't touch anything when you go out. Don't touch anyone when you go out. Don't touch your face. And number five is wash your hands frequently. Those five things are going to help us all get through this quicker so that we can stop the we can reduce the amount of transmissions and then hopefully get through the other side much, much quicker. So there you go, folks. Why don't you let us know if how that landed on socials, if there's anything that you want to contribute, something that we might need to answer, or one of your queries regarding that next week. But clearly, the main message is we're in this together. There's more that can be done from the governments and the banks. But also, if you are a landlord right now, be very, very mindful of what it means if you were to reduce the rent versus defer the rent. So hopefully that's given you some insights today, Ben. My life hack is really around the times, and I know that, that I was chatting with you that you're doing it, I'm also doing it in my household, but because we're working from home so much, we need to be really mindful of the fact that if you, whoever's the chief carer of young children or dependent children, to actually give them an opportunity, to get some sanity, Ben. So,
yeah, so to go for a walk.
I was trying to work out how I could say that appropriately, but it's just purely to give them some sanity. So the rhythm that you've established, the rhythm I've established, is they get out early. Whoever that chief person is that's looking after the loved ones, the young ones at home, let them get out so they can go for a walk and really clear their mind. Start the day with the podcast and feed them on with some really good stuff. And look for opportunities to chop out as you can throughout the day, because clearly I'm working a lot from the, with the exception of today, I had to come into the office for other reasons, but with the exception of today, I'm working from the home office, so we are around, but it's also just trying to manage that. So I know that there's people all over the country that are navigating scenarios where they're using kitchen tables for office desks. They've got young, medium, teenage children having around. Just let's all be mindful of working together. But my life hack today is, make sure you're getting out for your early morning walks, put some podcasts on, talk to your favourite virtual mentors, and make sure that it's good stuff going in. Ben, did you know?
So, Bryce, did you know? I thought, obviously, we're going to be talking about the impact on property prices and, you know, the headline-grabbing statements of property prices are going to drop by 20%. They're usually double what actually happens, for the record. I thought I'd always go back. You remember it was 40% and it ended up sort of being about 15%. Anyway, the point being is we are going to get into a lot of conversations around what's going to happen with property. Mm. And there's going to be, yep, some challenges in some aspects of the property market, which we'll be identifying in future podcasts. But I was pleasantly surprised, Bryce, when I saw CoreLogic, our good friends at CoreLogic, releasing their hedonic home value index for the month of March, considering that the coronavirus panic was, I mean, 2 weeks ago, it was at its peak. The share market was dive bombing. The world was collapsing. We saw emergency stimulus. It was as hard as and bad as it gets. And guess what? Property prices went up.
Come on.
Went up for the month of March. Don't. Sydney up 1.1%. Melbourne up 0.4%. Brisbane up 0.6, Adelaide 0.3, Perth 0.5, Hobart, the only capital city to go down, negative 0.2, Darwin up 2%, which is big for Darwin. Okay, Canberra up 0.6, so the combined capital is up 0.7, and the combined regional areas as well also up 0.6. So nationally, we were up 0.7. So not the big volatility that we're anticipating. Now, I'm no fool. I understand that people listening are going to say, wow, it's still to come, Bryce. It's going to come. We've been told it's going to come. And the reality might be that there might be some junk stock that is going to be sold over the course of the next couple of months. And I do suspect that the median house price is most likely nationally going to fall.
Yeah.
Lucky we don't buy the median house price in Australia, Bryce. Lucky there's opportunities where you buy the right properties in the right area, because the property market's still open, ladies and gentlemen. The property market is still open. So I thought I would just share that with you. So we are expecting that there will be some volatility, but nothing like we saw on the stock market, where from peak to trough in the Australian share market, 49%. From the top of the market points down to the bottom of the market. Now, March only finished, I think, about 23 or 24% down. So I'll talk more about that in my RBA announcement next week, because the reality is there's not going to be any announcement, because we know that the cash rate is going to stay at 0.25 until we have unemployment at 4.5%, or we have that inflation at 2 to 3%. So I still remain calm, Bryce. I still see opportunity out there. I am a man of my convictions in terms of what's going to be happening, and I see, for those people who are in a position to act, I see buying opportunities, Bryce.
Ben, I think you're right. It's important to remember it's not a balance sheet discussion now. It's a profit and loss discussion. We talked about that. It's a cash flow. How do we cash flow through this? Because the balance sheet will do whatever it's going to do, but if most people are making 10, 15-year decisions, right, what hasn't changed is there is a lack of stock. Mm-hmm. What hasn't changed is there's a pandemic of psychology as well. So that will not only play out in the next few months, where less building approvals and less construction will start, which means that we'll still have less stock available for an increasing mm-hmm. population. So people have just... And we talked about the lack of volatility. It's an illiquid asset. Think that through. Oh, I'm panicking. I've got to sell it. All right, well, I've got to get some agents through. Well, they can't get through very easily at the moment,
it's
Ben.
It's going to be slow.
And then I'm not going to do an auction campaign if I was doing auction, so I'm going to do private sale. And then I've got to go off to a solicitor, and I'm going to get the contract drawn up. And then I've got settlements to plan for, and then I've got to find a buyer, and then that buyer takes place. And so you actually can't get your money for quite some time, Ben. And then by the time that you can actually go through some of these decisions, we might have developments, and we see we're flattening the curve. And that's why...
It's a very civil process at the moment to buy property, Bryce.
But what's also interesting, Ben, is the tenants will want to think around the corner, because if we've got less stock, we've got more people moving here, and then on the other side, if we're increasing demand for rentals, which will put a little bit of upward pressure on the rents too, Ben, but say you're competing with someone who's prepared to pay X amount of dollars and someone else has paid the same amount of money, and they go onto the tenant register and see that you did the wrong thing during this time, you won't be able to get those properties that you're chasing.
No.
So again, sort of reinforcing. But I don't particularly expect to see wild fluctuations in property. I do think at headline level we will see some fluctuations, as you said, because the median price... The median price in Toorak will go down, Ben, if I was going to do a development of one-bedroom apartments in Toorak and drop them into that quarter.
But even if you had the mansion, Bryce, it's probably not going to be the best mansion for that month. So Toorak might only have 5 sales for the month. So that middle sale is more than likely, because not too many people are selling their beautiful big homes at the moment, are they?
Mm.
Usually the stock that gets sold in these types of times...
Is C-grade stock, Ben?
It's all C-grade. So you get the B's and the A's, and you've got to be quick on them.
Yeah.
And, you know, because they don't come up and we're hustling for them. But there's going to be plenty of what we call junk stock, penny stocks, coming onto the market, especially in medium and high density stuff, which has been impacted also by, education, foreign students, all of that. So there's definitely going to be some pressure in terms of...
And that'll drop the median, Ben. When you're selling off C properties, that'll drop the median.
And also...
Doesn't mean it affects A and B properties, though.
Correct. And the vacancy rates will probably creep up in that particular stock level. So you need to be really clear about the type of stock that you're going to be doing, because people are still moving. We still have mobility. Obviously, everything changes if we have further stringent lockdowns to essential services. But my understanding is the government has said construction and finance and banking is an essential service. So we still believe that the property market will remain open until we get to a more severe level, if we do get to a more severe level when it comes to COVID-19 and any coronavirus developments. So that's my message for today in the Did You Know, Bryce, is that
I
just thought it's important that people understand. So over the 3 months, the best performer was Sydney at 3.9%. Mm. Highest rental yields in the three-month period was Darwin at 5.9%. Weakest performing capital city across Australia was Darwin at 0.6%. And also Sydney had the lowest rental yields for the quarter at 3%. So I'm going to be looking at property over a quarterly basis, more so than the monthly basis, because it is going to be a bit choppy as we look at the data over the next couple of months. But we also know the other huge story here is volumes are going to be considerably lower. Yep. And if you don't need to sell your house, my advice is don't.
Yeah.
Don't.
Which is why on the other side, Ben, there will be an enormous amount of pent up demand. Yep. Which is, so fun fact, interesting fact, with our team, Ben, March is a month of two halves, right?
Yep.
It was the pre-corona hysteria post. We bought more properties in the second half as a team than we did in the first half. And you kind of think, okay, fair enough, there's a bit of an opportunity. But interesting, we engaged more clients in the second half than we did in the first half of the month. Now, that particular stat is really interesting because there are a few people who are saying this is where the opportunity exists. So,
because what we bought, 35
properties.
35 properties. Now, so what I love about our community is that the ones who are able to take action are doing that, and that's really good. And we're seeing that right across in terms of how we're helping people. So I cannot be more proud of the fact that people are listening. They've got a good mindset. For those who can act, are acting. And those people, what I also saw there was, you know, some data coming out of AFG and also coming out of the banks, is that there's a lot of refinancing going on. So people are also looking at their money management. And I think that's brilliant. So we'll be talking more about this in the coming weeks.
We will. So there you go, folks. Hopefully that's been information that'll help you digest for the rest of the week. So let us know what you want us to talk about. We're more than happy to cover off any of the concerns, issues or queries you might have during this time, Ben. But until next week.
Knowledge is empowering, boss, but only if you act on it.
Well said. See you next week, folks. Hey there, folks. Bryce Holdaway here. Before you go, if you're new to our community and only listened to maybe a handful of episodes, I thoroughly recommend that you go all the way back to episode number one, where we unpack all of the foundations when it comes to property investing. Now, for those of you that might be a little bit time poor, I've got good news for you. We have a binge guide that you can download straight away, which summarizes the first 20 episodes where Ben and I unpack the foundational pillars of the A, B, C, D, and so much more. And you can get that straight away. If you go to thepropertycouch.com.au/TPC20, you can download it and consume it whenever you want. It's completely free and available now. And for those of you, just a quick reminder that nothing we've spoken about today constitutes financial advice. We recommend that you reach out to your licensed professional advisor so that you can look at your unique circumstances before acting on any information. Now don't forget, go to thepropertycouch.com.au/TPC20 and get your binge guide today.